Hello and welcome back to our course Data Analysis in Astronomy and Physics, Lecture 2, Visualization. Today I would like to introduce basic concepts of data visualization. I will present examples of different types of visualization methods. We will talk in detail how to properly show error bars in logarithmic plots. And we will have a brief section on good practices in data visualization, the do's and don'ts. A large fraction of our brain is highly optimized to process visual data. Therefore, our brain is our prime instrument to analyze huge amounts of data. This already began 150 years ago with this plot showing the progress of the Napoleon, showing the progress of the Napoleon army moving to Moscow and back in the early 19th century. It is an n-dimensional data visualization showing, for example, the size of the army on the way to Moscow. This is the thickness of the light brown areas here in the plot. And on their way back from Moscow to France, this is the black part of the fraction of these bars. And on the bottom, we have, for example, weather conditions at certain periods of time. So we have the time dimension also encoded in this visualization. We have results of certain battles along the march of the army. We have influence of logistics during the march and so on. So this is a very nice example to visualize a very large and complex data set such that it fits on a single sheet of paper and can be analyzed just by looking at it. This figure has been created by Charles Joseph Minard 150 years ago. And it's a very nice example of advantages of good data visualization. The classical definition of visualization of data is the formation of a mental visual image. So it's the act of interpreting in visual terms or putting something into a visual form. Therefore, data visualization is a large field covering both information and also scientific visualization. And basically anything that converts data into a visual representation fits under this term. Scientific visualization is a subfield and it's about visualizing scientific data that has some close ties to real-world objects that can be visualized with their spatial properties, for example. A good example could be the airflow over the wing of an airplane or density or temperature structures in magneto-hydrodynamical simulations and so on. And the goal is very frequently to generate an image of something that we have spatial information about and maybe combine it with data that is less directly accessible, for example, temperature or pressure. And it's very common for the different fields to have very specific convention of how certain kinds of visualization are done. When we talk about information visualization, this is again a very broad term, which is covering most statistical charts and graphs and also metaphors that can be used to represent data sets that not necessarily have inherent spatial components. For example, the results of an election, population development, and so on. Here, infographic is a very specific sort of visualization. It has become very popular because it usually combines a lot of different statistical methods and visualization types with a certain narrative. And it can, of course, be also used to transmit a polemic message if you choose to do so. This is an example of such an infographic that summarizes Mars missions that successfully and partially unsuccessfully had been launched to fly to Mars. Method of data visualization itself to analyze the data. For example, it can be used to plot the data and then spot correlations just by visually looking at the data. It can be used to identify outliers that indicate, for example, an error in the measurement process, and so on. In fields where the data itself is visual, for example in astronomy, but also in medical fields, visual analytics may actually be the primary means of analyzing data. Think, for example, of a doctor analyzing an X-ray image or an MRI result. But also in astronomy, this is frequently used. And here I would like to give you an example. In spectroscopy, we usually handle very noisy measurements, and it is sometimes very difficult to assess whether the measurements detected a signal or not. Here in the top figure, I show you a very noisy signal. And one visual trick is to take the same spectrum and turn the sheet upside down to watch the spectrum upside down. And if something that you thought was a spectral emission line is still visible after turning the sheet, this is a good indication that it's actually there and not just a trick of your mind. To show you the result here, this is the Gaussian line that I embedded here in a strong noise component. And on the bottom figure, you see the same spectrum upside down. And if you look at it, you note that the depression here that corresponds to the stronger signal here is still visible. So that means you would visually say, yes, there we have a detection. You can smooth this, then it's more prominent. And if I change the noise, which is just generated by a random generator, and always we have the same underlying spectral line, you see that it is, if I switch off the actual Gaussian that is in there, it's not very easy to say whether we have a detection or not. In particular, if we only look off at the top figure. But if you look at the top and the bottom figure, you note that, yes, it's much easier to spot the signal. Another example of how visualization can be used to actually analyze the data is by spotting spatial features in observations. And this is in astronomy also done by creating maps of spectral measurements. On this figure, I show you on the left-hand side a grid of spatial measurements. So on this positions on the sky, imagine we detected these spectra. They are very noisy, and by looking at the spectra, it is not very easy to detect a certain spatial configuration. If we integrate every single spectrum, we have the advantage that much of the noise cancels out and the signal is left. And if we plot then these array of integrated spectra as a map and color coded, it looks like this. And if you look at the map now, you see the signal that I hit in the noise, which is here the square configuration. So on these positions, I embedded a certain Gaussian line in the spectra. So it's very easy by eye to spot this on the map. It's much less easy to see the same figure, the same structure on the left-hand side. This is a quote from a book by Thomas and Cook. People use visual analytics tools and techniques to synthesize information and derive insight from massive, dynamic, ambiguous, and often conflicting data. Detect the expected and discover the unexpected. Provide timely, defensible, and understandable assessment and communicate assessment effectively for action. This nicely describes the advantages and the tasks in visual analytics and the power that lies within this method. Of course, it is important to visualize data such that all the data is shown in an equal manner, nothing is emphasized or hidden just by technical means of the visualization. And one important aspect is how to encode certain numerical quantities to visual properties. For example, on this example, on this plots here, I plot the height of the geoid, so the deviation of the Earth from a perfect spherical shape, which are numbers plus and minus in units of meter. And this deviation I encode here with two different color scales, which are explained in the color bar next to the figure. On the left hand side, a very common color bar is being used. It is called rainbow because it uses the colors that are present in the rainbow, from the blue along the red, the green, yellow, to the red colors. This is visually very pleasing and is still in many software products the default setting. But it has many disadvantages, and if we look at the same data shown on the right hand side using a different scheming to convert a numerical quantity into a color, you see that the figure looks somewhat different. In particular, if we look, for example, in the bright red areas in the left figure that seem to be highly emphasized, and if we compare this to the figures on the right-hand side, they appear much less prominent. The same goes, for example, with the yellowish area, which is only a very, very narrow color band here in our color scale, but still appear very prominently. This color scale has a couple of problems. Some of them are related to how bright the colors are received by our eyes. They are not equally bright, or the brightness is not equally distributed along the whole color scale, which emphasizes certain numerical parts of our scale unevenly compared to others. It's also sometimes difficult for colorblind people to distinguish some of the colors here in the rainbow, which is why it is recommended not to use the rainbow color scale. Also, if we take the same figure and just convert them to grayscale, we note that the result is very different. And this is again, you see here on the left hand side in the color bar, the very brightish spots that are highlighted and the very dark things on the bottom and on the top of the color bar that give a skewed impression of the data compared to the figure on the right hand side. When we use colors, we have to be aware that with colors comes a certain difficulty, namely that perceptionally it is very difficult for us to assign a certain order to colors. Something that is very easy if we have a change, for example, in gray level on the left-hand side, it is very easy to put the black and gray disks in a certain ordering or spot when they are unordered, and it is not possible in the colored disks on the right-hand side because there is no inherent ordering between blue, red, yellow, and green in this example. So if we are using ordered data, be aware that this should be reflected in the choice of the color bar. We need to use a color scaling that does not introduce false gradients. And I try to show this in this figure. The top row is again the rainbow color scale, and looking at the left column, it looks like there is a very sharp gradient going from the blue to the green and then going from the green to the reddish part of the blot. Looking at the monochrome bar or at the others, we note that this is different. We also note that depending on what color bar we use, the data gives a slightly different impression. And this is particularly problematic if visual analytics is the predominant means of analyzing data, because we must take careful care not to hide parts of the data just by choice of our color scale. And this is shown here by comparing three different color scales. So these are the three columns of a certain data set. And there's also the fact that I can apply a particular mathematical scaling, an additional mathematical scaling, to convert our numeric quantities to the particular color. On the top row, I applied a logarithmic scaling, which is why the outside of the skull in this figure looks grainy, because we actually highlight also or give larger weight to also the very low signal, to the noise basically. And on the bottom row, I have chosen a linear scale. And we note that depending on what color scale we use, certain areas in the figure appear more or less prominent. For this reason, people invented new color scales such that some of the disadvantages that I explained to you are less prominent. For example, the Cube Helix color scheme is designed to have an even distribution of brightnesses going from the low number to the high numbers, so that no particular interval across our color bar is perceived as brighter than the other. This can be seen if we convert these color scales to black and white. We note that we have a very gradual increase of brightness going from the left to the right, while the rainbow color scale has some very bright areas at the cyan region and at the yellow part of the color scale. The Cube Helix scheme was also optimized to allow people with certain color blind conditions to be still distinguishable. And this is shown here in this simulation.